Morning. Welcome to Christian Outreach Fellowship. Let us bow for a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you. We praise you, Lord, for this day. We thank you just for this opportunity, Lord, to gather together in this place, Lord. Help us, Lord, not to take it for granted, God, but to just be grateful, Lord, just for your faithfulness and just providing this house of worship for us, God. We ask now, Lord, that you clear our hearts and our minds of the cares of this world, that this time may be set aside especially for you, Lord. Meet us here today, Lord, and just surround us with your love, Lord. Fill us with your spirit, Father. And we ask, Lord, that you bless those who are on their way. And we ask that you would just be our guest of honor, Lord, now as we worship you through song. In Jesus' name we thank you. Amen.
Will roar.
Sins, God, that separate us, Lord, separate our fellowship with you, Father. Lord, we thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord, just for who you are in our lives, Lord. We thank you, Lord, just for all of your promises, God. We just shout out to you this morning, Lord, and we just thank you and praise you, God, for this day, Lord. We thank you for your mercies I knew every morning, Lord, and we ask now as we continue, Lord, with the rest of this service that you would be lifted up and glorified in this place, Lord. We ask that you would bless the pastor as he brings forth your word today. Just encourage us today through your word, Father. And speak to our hearts, God, and open our eyes and our ears that we may hear and see you in the scriptures today, Lord. We love you, Lord, and we just magnify and glorify your name, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Jesus is Lord, whether you believe it or not. Amen. Are you saved from the wrath of God? Do you know that Jesus is your only hope? Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Run into his arms. Do it today before it's too late. The word for today, speak for your servant in listening. 1 Samuel 3:10. Bible study Wednesday night. Bible study is canceled until further notice, due to repairs are within the Sheffield Community Center. We encourage you to read ahead of the Gospel of John, chapter 3:5, and allow the Lord to speak to your heart as you prepare your heart for the next week message. The resource table is filled with many Christian books, magazines, pamphlet, tracts, music, movies, and other resources to help you to understand God's words and to grow in the grace and knowledge of who he is. All resources are available for free or to sign up for your usage. Please stop by after service today. Free copies of COF services. Audio recordings of COF services are available upon request. To request copies of any Sunday service, please sign up at the resource table. Also, all messages will be posted on YouTube by typing in Sunday church service. COF events. COF will be going to see Lacraine and Andy Manio live in concert October 29th at Fillmore Theater in Silver Spring, Maryland. If you are interested, please see Joshua Jones. Opportunity to serve. Here at Christian Outreach Fellowship, there are many opportunities to serve. If you would like to serve in any ministry here and can be faithful, committed, your gifts and talents are welcome and needed. To request more information regarding any ministry, please see Pastor Jones after service or sign up at the resource table. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another 1 Peter 4:10. Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hand so that his flocks and herd are spread throughout the land. Joel 1:10. Please stand and meet and greet one another in Jesus' name.
I just want to share over the offering today from 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Paul says in verse 6, "But I say unto you, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully." And what he's saying is that when you decide, okay, I'm going to give to the kingdom of God, and you say, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to do it in a large way, in a big way, meaning I'm going to do it in a big way in the sight of God, not in the sight of people, but I'm going to give to the point where it costs. Because remember, we talked about it here before, it's not the amount that we give, y'all know what I'm saying? But it's what it costs us to give that's important to God. That's why David said, I will not give God something that costs me nothing. So this is why it's important for us to understand this verse, because the next verse says in verse 7, so let each one give as he has purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or not of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. In so many words, when we give to the Lord, and we give to the kingdom of God, and we do it we give a lot, meaning that we get to the point where it hurts, then, and we give out of the desires of our heart to do so, not grudgingly and so forth, then God will bless us. And it says in verse 8, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always have in all sufficiency, all things. So God says he'll provide for us, and he'll make sure that we have everything we need when we give to the kingdom of God. Let me pray. Father, I pray that you bless everyone who gives today. Bless those who have desire to give but didn't give. Let them know, God, that there's a blessing. There's more blessings to give than to receive. Bless them with that knowledge. And we pray, Father, that you bless us with a deeper understanding of your will when it comes to giving. And we pray, Father, that you bless everyone who gave today. Lord, we pray, Father, that you would give them more seed to sow into your kingdom. And Lord, you said if we give bountifully, we will be blessed bountifully. If we sow sparingly, we will reap sparingly. Help us understand that sowing and reaping principle, Father. And help us to give, not grudgingly, but out of a desire to be pleasing to you. We thank you, Father, and love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have a song here by Fred Hammond. Some of you may have seen the video. The name of the song is Trust in the Name of the Lord. And in the video, the young lady has some form of a sickness. We're not exactly sure. But she goes to the doctor. I wish I could show the video while we played the song because it is very powerful. She goes to the doctor and she doesn't exactly know what's wrong with her. And so they run some tests. And it appears that it could be some type of sexual transmitted disease. And she is afraid of what it might be. Her friends come over and encourage her and comfort her and everything else. But then eventually her friends leave. And how many have been in situations in life where, you know, you have people comfort you when you go through difficult times, but then they leave, meaning that they got to go back to work, they got to go back to their family, they got to go back to life, and you realize you're there all alone. And while she was alone, she began to trust in the name of the Lord to ask him to help her to see her through that difficult time. And at the end of the video, they just show her going into the doctor's office. And I just want to pray that that all of us would come to a trust in God where we would understand that maybe you haven't experienced life long enough to the point where you have been in a situation like that. But whether it be a disease, and whether it's a sickness you cause, somebody else cause, whatever it might be, that day will come, as I always share. It's going to be playing at a movie theater near you soon, meaning that in life, you're going to have difficulties. And you got to learn. You must learn to trust in Jesus when you go through difficult times. And no one else can trust for you. Only you can do that. So can we all stand and worship together?
Won't bring them.
stand before you, help us to realize that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and there they're saved. Help us to know, Lord, that when we go through difficult times, we can call on you, Lord. We can call you Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Rapha. All these names that we can come up with, God, that are mentioned in your word to remind us of the fact that you're a healer. You're the one that gives us peace. You're the one who gives us comfort. You're the one who fights for us. You're El Kabor. You're all these great names, God. Help us to know that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. We love you, Dad. We pray, Lord, that at this particular time, I would decrease, you would increase. My words would be your words. Give us, as usual, a heart to understand and ears to hear, and help us to desire to run after Jesus, to run after you, Lord, and to give up all, to forsake all in order to be pleasing to you. We thank you, Father, and we love you. Now open up your word, and as we open your word, help us to behold wondrous things from out of your law. And we love you and thank you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. We've got a lot that we would like to speak about today, so hopefully we'll, as usual, we have our scriptures up here. I pray that you all would jump on that and spend time in the Word of God. When you study to show yourself approved unto God, workman, you not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. There's a Bible in the back. If anybody would like one, it's got like no cover on it, so it's in the back. So if not, you can maybe stick with me. All of you, actually, because the first verse that we'll probably be dealing with is 1 Thessalonians 5:18, so you all can probably turn there. But the first thing we want to deal with is our expressions of worship in the book of Psalms today. What are some ways in which you think God would have us to worship? Anyone want to share with us? Just some ways.
How he wants us to worship.
How he would have us to worship. Or what are some ways in scripture you see people worshiping? You see people doing what? Lifting their hands, okay? In fact, we're told in 1 Timothy chapter 2 that men ought to lift their hands, by the way. They ought to lift up holy hands everywhere. And by the way, worship, when we worship the Lord, lifting your hands is a sign of surrender to the Lord. It's also a sign, God, that I bow myself as I stand before you, God. I lift my hands to you, God, in a way of adoration and praise. Some people say that the trees worship the Lord because they're all going straight up towards God. You know what I mean? But when we lift our hands, we're saying, God, I surrender to you. I love you, Lord. I want to touch heaven with my love for you, Lord. And so, as I said before, 1 Timothy 2, men are generally seen as those that lead worship. In fact, we know this from 1 Chronicles chapter 25, that it's usually the men that lead. The priests in the Old Testament led worship. And then we got Deborah and we got Miriam in the Old Testament who kind of did it at times, but it was mainly the men. So when you go to church, the men should be the main ones worshiping. Not to say the women should too, they should be worshiping too, but you should see men. You should see men involved in worship. Are y'all feeling me on this? What are some other ways in which we can express our worship and love for God in the book of Psalms that you see? Somebody want to share just something else. What else do you do here on Sunday morning? In fact, how many of you lift your hands during service?
Right.
Just since I mentioned that, how many of you lift your hands during service? What is that about? Why don't you do it? What else can we do? What's this? How many of you clap your hands during service? How many of you do that? How many of you ever clap hard? How many of you ever clap on time? How many of you been to church with whatever? You know what I'm saying? How many ever clap? I mean, you can get your exercise in church. You know what I'm saying? You start raising your hands, clapping your hands, stomping your feet. You can really get some exercise during service. But let me say this. I always think this is funny. And some people think it's stupid, but I think it's funny. I always share that when we get to heaven, the Lord's going to make us hook up with the white churches or the Caucasian churches because, you know, you ever been to usually a Caucasian church, they can't clap on time. You ever notice that? They always, you know, they be off beat, you know what I'm saying? But we be on beat, you know what I mean? But he's going to hook us up with a Caucasian church so that they can, we can teach them how to clap on time, and they can teach us how to come to church on time. Are y'all with me? As you know, in our community, we're always running late. Anyway, but clap our hands. What are some other expressions? That's all y'all know to do?
You
Okay. All right. Well, now, Ms. Francis says we sing to the Lord. Okay. And if some of you don't know the words, so it's kind of, sometimes kind of hard to sing. We used to have a thing that we had up on the board where we would project the words. And we'll start putting them back in the bulletin or something. But anyway, sing. How many of you like to sing? How many of you sing in the shower to the Lord? How many of you sing when you walk in to the Lord? How many of you sing when you're in the car to the Lord? How many of you sing to the Lord? You know what I mean? Just praise the Lord and sing. And some of us can't really sing that well. How many of you notice that? How many of you been next to somebody in the church who can't sing that good? You know what I mean? Maybe, oh, trust in the name of the Lord. But hey, they're just praising God. That's all good. Now, should they lead worship? Oh, Jada says no. No, they can't sing. They should be up here. But no, at times I do think, you know, people like that can lead worship. You know, I love it when I go to some churches and they have like a choir and they all take turns singing a song. They all have a song to sing in that choir. Okay. And that's cool. But then sometimes you have some who sing specific songs. And we know from 1 Chronicles 25, we have Asaph as well as He-Man and others who had the ability to sing. And these were the ones who led God's people. And they were men priests who led God's people in worship. Okay. So I do think that needs to be, you know, done in the right way. How about musical instruments? Can we use musical instruments? Now, years ago, the Seventh-day Adventist Church had this thing where they really didn't allow certain instruments, I think like percussion instruments and stuff like that. So they didn't allow drums and you know, I think it was some other instruments they just would not allow. Now that's not the case, but it used to be that way. But you know, instruments are cool. You know, I remember I went up to Joshua's school and last year when they were first starting and they had, you know, all these instruments, but this one guy decided he would play on a box, and he sounded like the drum. God, like, hey, I gotta get that box. Wherever he got that box from, it's just like a regular shoebox, you know. So that's all good, you know. And what else? You know, how about dancing? Dancing. Can't we dance to the Lord? How many ever danced to the Lord? You ever do that before? You may ever do that before?
Not in here.
Not in here. Okay, but you ever done it before? Period. Okay. All right. I remember some years ago we had this thing where we would do. We had someone here who we would dance to the Lord. And we didn't really dance to the Lord in this church, but I'm saying, I said, well, I went to a church and I saw them dancing to the Lord. And I said, why don't we try this Lord dance? And it was like an OCDO. And I mean, we went around and I grabbed everybody's arm and we, you know, and it was very, you know, fun for the Lord. But this one person was like, no, I'm not doing that. I'm not dancing with you to the Lord. I'm like, okay, I'm sorry. But you can dance to the Lord. I think that's cool, you know. David danced with all his might, you know, and I do think that's fine. But you ever notice that some people have an issue with that? You know, I've gone to some churches and the people have been running. I mean, I've seen that before. You know, it's kind of scary, you know what I mean? You see somebody running full speed around the church and screaming, ah! And somebody then, you know, there's usually a runner, and then there's a chaser, the person who chases them down. You ever seen that before? And I've been to a few churches like that, and I'm like, man, you know, somebody needs to, you know, get that person for somebody stick their foot out and that person go fly, you know what I mean? So it's one of those things where the running stuff, I always said to myself, well, if you do that here doing service, you're running around like that, are you doing that at home? You know what I mean? When the music starts at home, are they running around, Miss Francis? We're running around the house, you know? I doubt that, but it seems like when they come to church, that's when they start the running stuff, you know? So I just think we gotta be careful of that. Because, you know, some people, as I've shared before, some people come to church and they do the zombie. Some people, you know, y'all seen the zombie when they come out like a zombie, you know? And praise God, if that's the way you wanna worship, you know? You know, if that's how you do it, then that's all good. And some people do the running man. Like I said, they go running around. And some people do the jerk. You ever seen that? But it's just, you know, some people do that stuff. You know, so we all have ways of expressions of worshiping God. And just as long as we shared in here before, as long as we know from 1 Corinthians 14, and especially verse 40, we do all things decently and in order. And we know that God is not the author of confusion. So we got to be careful of that kind of thing. Are y'all with me on that? So anyway, and not only that, you know, God wants us to make a joyful noise. He wants us to make a shout unto the Lord. He wants us to lift our hands. He wants us to dance. He wants us to clap. He wants us to play musical instruments for his glory and for his honor. Are y'all with me on that? But not to draw attention to yourself. And I think this is something we got to be careful about. If you ever go to a church and someone is drawing attention to themselves by what they do, then the attention is no longer on God, it's on them, and then that's a problem. Now, we've had this situation here before where people do certain things during worship and their attention is drawn to them, and it's no longer on God, and that is a problem, because we're here to worship the Lord, not to watch them, all right, run around or do whatever they might do. Are y'all feeling me on this? Amen. Somebody say amen, yeah? And if you had that desire that you want to dance, we got, what we have done is to the Lord, we have set up a whole section here at COF in the back. You can go back there and dance if you want during service, or if you want to run, there's not a lot of room, but just run back there, you know what I mean? In a circle, I guess. Or you can go in there and run. We'll turn the music up for you. Praise the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
All right, say amen. Okay. Our thought of the day, turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. That's in the New Testament. And look at what God tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. He says that we are as his people. And most of us know this verse by heart, but he gives thanks in all things. Okay? So look what it says here in verse 18. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you or for you. Okay? So whatever situation that we're in, we should be giving God thanks. Are y'all feeling in this? We should be thankful that you know, God is with us in the midst of the situation that we're in. Notice what it says, give thanks in all things. I have it here up on the board. In all things, whatever situation you're in, give thanks while you're in that particular situation. Are y'all feeling me on this, you know? I remember some time ago when Lisa and Joshua, when he was small, they got in an accident off of St. Charles Parkway. They were going down to some place where the children meet, and some woman who was on her cell phone had slammed into the back of our van. We had a green Windstar, and it slammed in the back of it. And Lisa called me and said, we were just in an accident. I said, well, what happened? She said, somebody slammed. I said, are you okay? She said, I'm fine. I said, is Joshua okay? He said, yeah, that we're just shaking up, because she pretty much totaled the vehicle. And so, you know, my thought at the moment, immediately, God put it on my heart. This is going to be good. Don't you worry. This is going to be good. God's going to work this out. That was our vehicle that we used to get around, to do church stuff, to do all. It was our vehicle. But he put that on my heart. Well, guess what happened? That car was totaled out. We tried to fix it, tried to do it. It just was unfixable. God gave us money where we could buy that silver van. It's that now thing. It's old now. That's 2005. But God provided, you know? And so, listen, whatever you're going through, in the midst of it, God says to be thankful. Look for a way to be thankful. You know, don't be like some people. I mean, you know, people just, and everything they go through, they're not thankful, they're ungrateful. Everything they go through, they're not that thankful, they're mad, they're sad, whatever it is. God says that we're to be thankful in the midst of it. Now, y'all with me? You know, some people always find the bad in a situation. Start looking for the good, something to be thankful. God says in the midst of everything, be thankful. It's just like I heard someone say, you know, the other day, I heard this story. This man said that I work digging ditches. That's a construction site. I dig ditches so that I could pay for my house, so that I could take care of my family, so that I can send my kids to school, so that I can buy food, so that I can get more strength to get up the next day to dig the ditch. Okay? Right? And this is the mentality that many of us have. God doesn't want us to see life like that. Are y'all feeling me? In fact, look at Ephesians chapter 5, verse 20. So God tells us here in 1 Thessalonians 5, 18, to be thankful in everything. Look what it says here in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 20. And I'll read it. God says, giving thanks always for all things. So not only are we to be thankful in all things, we're to be thankful for all things. No matter what the situation may be, no matter what the situation might bring, I'm going to be thankful for all things. Now, when he says this, I think in a lot of ways, this particular thankfulness for all things, you know, may not happen while we're in it. So that's why God says be thankful in all things. But lots of times when we're through with the situation and we step back and we reflect on what God has done, then all of a sudden we look at it, and then eventually, Lord willing, hopefully we'll become thankful for all things. You know, as I went through my situation, I remember Brother Mike told me, he said, man, you know what? When this is all over with Junior and you look back on this, you're going to be thankful for what you went through. And I'm not telling you that you should, you know, if someone punches you in the mouth and knocks out all your teeth, that all of a sudden you should be thankful. Oh, Lord, I thank you. My teeth are knocked out. Oh, God, you're so good. Here's 5 teeth and, you know, I got to go to the dentist again. No, I'm not saying that. And I don't think that's necessarily what God is saying. But what I think he's saying is that once in these situations, when we go through these situations, as time goes on, we could look at it and say, you know, God, I thank you. Because you know what? He could have killed me. I could have lost my life. I'm still here. Look for the good in the midst of it. So if you do that, then you can be thankful not only in all things, but for all things. Are y'all feeling me on this? You know, sometimes Lisa gets on my nerves, and I love her. You know, but you know, she has said, like, I'll say something like, and she says vice versa. I'll say something like, you know what, because I got a hard time with, because of all the treatment I have a hard time with saliva. Okay, I don't really have my saliva. So it bothers me at times really bad, because I have really bad dry mouth and it affects my teeth. And sometimes I'll lose a filling. I'm in a dentist's office, I would say probably. At one point, I was in there probably like 15 times to 20 times a year because of my teeth, drilling and the rest of this. And I'm telling you, I remember one time a filling came out, and it was while I was eating, and I was like, Father, I'm sick of this, you know. At least it turned out well. At least you still got your head, you still got your brain, you could be dead, you know. I'm like, what? Could be dead? But she was right. She was looking for the good in the midst of it. You can still drink, can't you? We got to look for the good in the midst of whatever we might go through. Are y'all feeling on this? Turn to Job chapter 1. Job chapter 1. Next thing we're going to deal with is our question of the day. And we're rolling through this in the application and our teaching of the day, our question of the day. You know, what is a hedge? Does anyone know? Now let's look at it. Let's look at it real quick. We'll come back to that question. Look in Job chapter 1. Look what it says in verse 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. It talks about just how, really through verse 5, how Job pleased the Lord. He was a blessing to God. How he prayed for his family. He made sacrifices for him. How did Job fear God? Job was blameless. He walked. He was an upright man. He did everything, it seems like, for the most part, in his ability. He did what was pleasing in the sight of God. And then it says in verse 6, now there was a day when the sons of God came together to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. And it says in verse 7, and the Lord said to Satan, from where have you come? And he says, and Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro throughout the earth, from walking back and forth on it. And then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? There's none like him in all the earth or all the land, a blameless and upright man who fears God and shuns evil or hates evil. And Satan answered and said unto them, does not Job fear you for nothing? Verse 10 says, have you not put a hedge around him, around his household, and around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, as Miss Francis read earlier, and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and surely he will curse you to your face. And so many words, you know what, remove that hedge. Now, what's a hedge? Covering. What else?
Covering protection.
Anyone else want to say what it could be? What is a hedge? What is something, you know, if you look in the dictionary, what would it be? It would be, yes, something that would kind of, you know, and you know, protect something, or something that surrounded a particular thing to keep something out. I got a picture here I put in here of a shepherd, and it's hard to see in this picture. He's at that particular time in the days of Christ, David, the rest of them, they would have a sheepfold area. And they would have, they would put these rocks up and on top of each other, and they would build an area in which the sheep could not get out. And then the shepherd would lay at the door of the fold so that they couldn't get out. And this is why Jesus said, "I am the door." You know what I mean? And I am the good shepherd. These things. So that's what a shepherd would do to make sure they couldn't get out, to make sure they were safe, provided for, and the rest of this. I got a picture here too of a house that has hands over top of it, protecting it in case of storms or anything else that may come that way when it comes to that house. Now in our lives, I believe that the Lord puts a hedge around us. I believe he puts a hedge around us of protection to keep things keep Satan from attacking everything that we own. Because if God took that away, then Satan would just come and destroy our lives. So I believe that God does this. I've shared the story before about the girl who was walking down the street and how that she's walking through an alley, I believe, and this guy decided he was going to rob her. And then all of a sudden, he decided not to. And so the cops stopped him, and because he had robbed someone else, and they got him and said, "Well, you robbed this person. Are you going to rob anybody else?" He said, "Yeah, I was going to rob this other girl, but she had two big dudes with her, and there was no way I was going to do that." Well, they caught up with the girl, and she said, "I didn't have anybody with me. I'm by myself." Well, we believe that those two people that were with her were definitely her angels. You know what I mean? Watching over her in the midst of it. I think that God watches over our home. I think he watches over our water heaters in our house. You know what I mean? I saw the other day where this house exploded because it had a natural gas explosion. Did y'all see that on the news? I mean, I thought to myself, wow, that could be my home. You know what I mean? That could be where I'm at. That, I've seen apartment buildings where they just blown up because of that kind of stuff. But God puts a hedge. I think he puts a hedge on our cars. These pieces of junk that we ride around in, I believe it's God who's got angels inside there holding spark plugs together. You know what I mean? Holding that wheel on that keeps making that noise. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Holding that gas tank in so it won't fall out on the ground. I think it's all God. I think it's God who's keeping the devourer, it mentions in Malachi. Remember, he says that when you give, I will keep the devourer away from you. And I think in many occasions when Satan wants to devour our substance and everything else, God puts a hedge around us to protect us. Are y'all feeling that? So God does his part. Isn't that an awesome thing? I think he's got a hedge in here now to keep us while we're in here now. That's why no one's coming here and blowing our brains out. You know what I mean? Because God has put a hedge around us. So he's done his part. What about our part? Turn quickly over to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. In the back of the Bible, 1 John 5. I'm going to say this real quick because we got to move because of time. 1 John chapter 5, verse 18. So God has done his part, but now look at what our part is. It says, look, we know that whoever is born of God does not sin, but he who has been born of God keeps himself, and the wicked one does not touch him. If you're living a life that's pleasing to God, Satan cannot come and destroy your life. Okay? If you're living a life that's pleasing to God, there is a hedge around you. And literally, this means that if you're not living in a constant sin, then God sets up protection around you. I believe that. So to some degree, the protection that we have is based upon our obedience to God. It's almost like, you know, at home, let's say you got an alarm system at home. That system is set up to protect you. But it doesn't work until you go over and do what? Turn it on. It's your responsibility to turn it on. Doesn't do you any good. So God is the same way. It's our response. God does his part, and then we're told to do our part. In fact, we're even told to pray in Matthew chapter 6, verse 13. Remember what's known as the Lord's Prayer. Some would call it, "Our Father who what? Who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our what? Our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from what? Okay, some of your newer translations say, deliver us from the evil one. So we've been praying that God would keep protection from us. Jesus said in John, is it chapter 17, where he said, "I pray, Father, that you keep them from the wicked one." So there's a hedge of protection around us. Now, is that protection ever removed? At times, yeah. If God has another purpose. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 20, you've been bought with a price. You're not your own anymore, Jerome. You don't do what you want to do. You don't do what you want, Lisa. You've been bought. God decides what he wants to do with us. And we need to be willing to submit ourselves to that, brother friends. So if today's the day, Jayla, the Lord says, Jayla, I want you to be a sacrifice that many may come to know Jesus. Would you be willing to do that? I've shared a story about Lynn Bias' brother before. How remember Lynn Bias? Lynn Bias died. His brother was at the PG Plaza, I think a couple years afterwards, and his brother had given his life to Christ, got into an issue with someone there, and the guy put out a gun and shot him, killed him. Hundreds of young guys and young youth came to the funeral. You know, it was really sad because his mom had lost Lynn Bias plus his brother. At that funeral, they say hundreds of kids gave their life to Christ. That's the corn of wheat fall in the ground and die, it abides alone, Jesus said. But if it dies, dies there in that ground, it produces much more, you know? It opens up and produces much more. And I think that you got to ask yourself, am I willing to lay down my life to build up the kingdom of God? And sometimes that hedge God will remove for his glory. You know, I've shared the story about the girl in Columbine. And how it was in 1999 in Columbine, out in Colorado, I think it was, how that Casey Bernil was her name, how that she had been telling people about Jesus in the school, during school time, Janice, going around telling people about Jesus, they need to get saved, the rest of that. They didn't want to hear it. And these gothic dudes, you know, them people that wear the all black, you see them up at your school, Jerome? And folk wearing black, looking all weird, man, with black lipstick and the rest of that stuff. Well, this is what they had, black fingernail polish, black, I don't know. Anyway. I never seen any black people doing that, y'all. It's kind of because we, you know, we didn't show up real well. We had black lipstick. You know what I mean? I don't know. Anyway, two of these guys decided that they would, because she had been witnessing to them. They come up to the school shooting anybody up, so they come up to her and they say, "Yeah, do you trust with a gun in her face? Do you trust Jesus now? You trust Jesus now?" She said, "Yes, I believe Jesus died for me as my Lord, my Savior," and they blew her away. Great is her reward, though. Great is her reward in heaven. Great is her reward. So sometimes God will remove that hedge for his glory. And you'll get great rewards if you submit to him. But also keep this in mind. The Lord has set up a hedge to protect us from, you know, from our own self. Hosea chapter 2, verse 6. Hosea 2, 6. Now, most of you don't know what I said. But remember, if you go to the Old Testament, you get Jeremiah, you get Ezekiel. And then you get Jeremiah, Lamentation, Ezekiel. You get Daniel. Right after Daniel is Hosea. Hosea chapter 2, verse 6. God says that he set up, Hosea 2, 6. He set up a hedge around his people, so that, Brother Vince, they would not sin. So there's a hedge that God has set up so that to protect us from evil, but he's also set up a hedge if to keep us from doing sinful behavior. I never went to do something sinful, and all of a sudden it was just difficult to do it. You know what I mean? Maybe you're just going to do something you shouldn't have did, and all of a sudden you get a phone, what you was going to do, and all of a sudden you get a phone call, and they're like, "Hey, what's up? Praise the Lord." You know what I mean? All of a sudden, somebody calling, "Hey, what you doing, man? You know, or hey, what's happening, girl? You know, but you was going to do something you know you weren't supposed to do." And it's God just reaching out to you, trying to stop you from doing that, putting up roadblocks. But sometimes we, you know, if you ever look at the story of Samson and how many roadblocks God set up. You know, Samson's mom and dad said, "Listen, that's wrong. You shouldn't be doing this, messing with these women and these unbelieving women." Samson wanted to do it anyway. You remember that? Remember Samson, to get his women, mainly Samson went to somewhere else. He had to leave, travel to other places, fight all these people just to get the women he wanted, where he wanted to lay it and have fornicate with this one and that one. He had to go through a lot just to do that. Remember David, at the time of war, in the spring when soldiers or kings went out to war, here David's at home. He's running, and remember, he sees this woman, Bathsheba, over there, you know, bathing, and all of a sudden he calls for her. And someone says, "Listen, David, this is," the first thing they told him is, "Yes, this is Uriah's wife." David went right past the roadblock. Didn't want to see it. Just, you ever see a sign that says, "Road closed"? Would you drive down a road that said, "Road closed"? Well, as Christians, some of us do that. We just keep going, even though road closed. It reminds me of the story I've heard about how they catch monkeys over in Africa. To catch monkeys, you know what they do? They put a banana inside of a jar. And what they say is monkeys take their hand and put it in that jar and do whatever they can to get that banana out. They're trying whatever, whatever. And so all of a sudden, here comes the guys to catch the monkeys. And the monkeys start trying to swing from tree to tree with one arm because the other arm is attached to the banana and they refuse to let it go. This is how many of us are. So God puts up a hedge, and this hedge sometimes is painful to us when we go in those directions. And God is saying, you know why it's so painful that you messing with this dude or you messing with this girl or you're doing this? Because it's not for you, but you're pressing through it anyway. And let me just say this too. The Lord puts up a hedge when we turn determined to turn back to him. Remember the story of the prodigal son? Remember the guy messed up, did all this, and then he came to his senses and decided, I'm going to go home and I'm going to be a servant to my father. And on his way back home, he runs to him. You know why his father came running to him? To protect him from being stoned to death. If you turn back to God and say, Lord, I'm going to serve you with my whole heart. I love you, I'm going to serve you with my whole heart because I know you're real Lord. If you do that, then guess what? God will put that hedge of protection around you to protect you. In many cases, from some of the consequences that may come your way. Amen? Last thing I want to deal with today. Now, I'm not going to deal with this. I'm going to say this next week, my application today, but I'm going to deal with the devil so we can get this out the way for the next 20 minutes. Turn over quickly to 1 John chapter 3. And in the back of the Bible, verse 8. You remember last time we was here, we was talking about the devil. And then we said that we have three enemies, the world, the flesh, and who else? The devil. And then we saw how that the devil has a kingdom set up. And within his kingdom, remember, he's in charge. Then he's got territorial demons. He's got boss demons. He's got groupie demons. He's got single demons. And remember, we said his kingdom is set up just a lot like the way God set up his kingdom in heaven. Because Satan is not an originator. He's an imitator. And remember, we saw where he came from. Remember, we saw at one point he was an angel. Up in heaven, he was a cherubim we saw last week, and he was kicked out because he decided that he would rebel against God. Satan was kicked out as well as one third of all the angels. Remember, we saw that last week. We saw that some of them decided that they would have sex with women in Genesis chapter 6. So because of that, some of them were chained up. So right now, we have a bunch of demons running around, and we have Satan in charge of them, or Lucifer, as we saw last week in some translations. Remember, we saw that Satan has never been to hell. These demons that we have here roaming the earth have never been to hell. They are terrified of hell. Remember, we saw how the demons, not only that, but they know that their time is short. We saw this last week, and I'm going to look at it again. And we saw that the day is going to come from Revelation chapter 12 where Satan realizes his time is short. So they're afraid of all these things, and they're terrified, really, of us. And I want us to understand this regarding the enemy, because we're going to look at what Satan does all day, because and what his demons do all day. Some of you think that they're just sitting around watching TV. No, they're doing some other stuff. Okay, they're busy. All right. By the way, they're spirits, and spirits do not need rest like we do as human beings. Look over in 1 John chapter 3. Look what it says in verse 8. I want us to understand a few things before we move forward. Look what it says. It says, he who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. It says, for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he may destroy the works of the devil. And notice within the context, he's mainly talking about the works of the devil regarding sin. So understand this, the power that Satan had over our lives when it comes to sinning and the rest of this. Listen, we don't have to live like that anymore. Jesus defeated that on the cross. Colossians chapter 2. You all can turn here, or I'll just read it. Colossians chapter 2. Look what it says in verse 15. It says something that Jesus did on the cross. Look what it says. Having disarmed principalities. This is referring to demonic forces. In Colossians 2:15. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Now, back in that day, whenever a king would win a war, what they would do, Brother Vance, is that they would bring all those who they have defeated. They would chain them up and have a parade and parade them in front of everybody, showing that they had defeated that particular enemy. Well, God has done the same thing. He defeated Jesus defeated Satan. He defeated the devil. He defeated his demons at the cross. So guess what? Now we are not only conquerors, we are more than conquerors, Romans 8 tells us at the end. And guess what else he did at the cross? We know from Ephesians chapter 4, and I'll read it, or you can turn there. Ephesians 4:18. I'm moving real fast because of time. But Ephesians chapter 4, and verse 18, it says that when Jesus, and I believe this happened at the cross because the context is that, it says having their understanding darkened, being enlightened, it talks about so forth, the blindness and so forth. It talks about how he gave gifts to men. How that Jesus gave gifts to men. In fact, look at verse 8, and I'm at the wrong verse. Ephesians 4, verse 8. It talks about how he ascended up to, he also ascended, also descended down to earth in verse 7. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gifts. It says, therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive, and he gave gifts to men. And then it goes on to talk about just some of the gifts that he gave. And I believe that once Satan was defeated, gifts were handed out. And that's how it was at that particular time. When the enemy was conquered, gifts were handed out. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28, verse 20, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and earth. Now you go. Greater is he, 1 John 4:4, greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. So look in Hebrews chapter 2. Let's look at some of the stuff that demons do all day and Satan has done all day long from day one. Look what it says in verse 14. Hebrews 2 verse 14. Insomuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shed in the same way through death, that he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. One of the things that the devil had at one point was the power of death. 99% of all human beings are fearful of dying. Fearful, terrified of dying. Remember in Job chapter 2. Remember what Satan said about Job. He said, skin for skin, all will a man give Jerome for his life. Have you noticed that? You let somebody start shooting up at the school somewhere. What's going to happen? What are most people going to do? Run. You ever seen that on TV? They don't care. Even if somebody came in with a gun, people be running over me. Get out the way, Pastor, right now. You know, get out. You are in the way. You know what I'm saying? They are just because skin for skin, all will a person give to save their life. And Satan knows that. And because of that, he uses death to scare even God's people. I shared before how the demons got together. And how they all got together, this is just a joke story. People used to say the demons got together, and once they all got together, Satan was with them, and Satan said, I want to show y'all something. He said, what is it? I got this great big gun. And so they said, wow, look at this gun. He said, what you going to shoot, Satan? You going to shoot Christians with that? He said, yeah. He said, look what I got. He pulled out this little tiny pill, and on the top of that pill was the word fear. He said, I'm going to shoot this into the heart of every Christian that's out there. And let me just say this. Listen, many of you are fearful of dying. Do you realize that once Jesus rose from the dead, the disciples were not fearful of dying? In fact, they prayed, and it's in Acts chapter 4, God give us more boldness. They were no longer fearful of dying. Are you afraid to die? You need to have the mentality, okay, remember what Jesus said. It's in Luke 12, where he said, listen, don't be afraid of him when you destroy your body, and after that, do nothing else. You need to have the mentality, okay, if you kill me, now what? I'll live forever. Do you really believe that? You see, if you believe that, which the disciples did, it got to a point where it didn't matter. Hebrews 11:35 says that some people who were being tortured said, you know what, don't deliver me. When people said, we can get you out of this situation, they said, no, I'm seeking a better resurrection. I don't even care. Just put me out because I know I'm going to go be with Jesus. You know what I mean? But when you're afraid of dying, guess what? Satan will use that against you the rest of your life. So that's one of the things he goes around doing. Second Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4 says, if our gospel would be hid, it's to them who are lost, when the God of this world is blind of mind and them that believe not. One of the things that Satan does, he goes around and he does whatever he can to stop people from hearing the word of God. To blind them. I was up here at Target a couple weeks ago, and there's a woman out there, she was passing out some pamphlets for something. They were giving away backpacks for kids or something, or trying to raise money for backpacks. And so I said, well, she's about 75 or something like that. And I said, you know what's going to happen to you when you die? She said, yeah, I'm going to heaven. I said, well, how do you get to heaven? She said, well, by doing good and doing good things to other people. I said, wow. I said, how old are you, man? She said, like 75. I said, man, that's not how you get in. She said, well, how do you get in? I said, you got to trust Jesus as your Savior and believe that he died for you and rose again, make him the Lord of your life. She said, yeah, that's true too, yeah. I said, well, don't depend on your good works because they're not going to get you in. She said, I guess that's true, you know. I said, yes, ma'am. Ma'am, it is true. He does whatever he can to stop people from hearing the word. And you know, in this country, it is like a backwards way of doing things. I don't know if y'all realize how Satan works. It's almost like we got Bibles everywhere, don't we? You name it. I mean, you know, we have access to all types of ways of hearing the word of God. And it's to the point, it's like, you know, how many ever someday say to yourself, you know what? And this only happens in America. I'm hungry. And maybe you got some money in your pocket. You know what? I'm hungry. I don't know what to eat. And then you go down a list of things to eat. Wow. This, that, you know, Popeyes, KFC, McDonald's. Man, it ain't. Didn't you ever say to yourself, man, it ain't nothing to eat? You know why? Because we live in a society where we have so much. And it's the same way with the word. We have it so much around us, TV, radio. I mean, you name it. I mean, you know, people throwing away Bibles. They got so many of them. You know, they're just everywhere. And because of that, guess what? That's been a deterrent for many people from hearing the word of God. Satan's used that to blind people. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 18, he blocks the word. Paul said that he wanted to go and share the word of God, but Satan had gotten in the way of it. And you know what's interesting about it? I remember Tim Tebow. You remember Tim Tebow, the football player who used to play for Florida? I read him on TV the other day. I heard him on a video, and he was talking about how that, you know, he painted under his eyes, Philippians 4, verse 13, I believe it is. I can do all things in Christ who strengthens me, I think. And then he put John 3:16 under his eyes. So every time, you know how they put the camera on it, you know, you're down, it's up, it'd be John 3:16, you know. You know, after a while, they got sick of that. And guess what they did? They said, no one is allowed. The NFL did it too, as well as the NBA. I'm sorry, the NFL, as well as, because the NBA don't wear face paint, but or eye paint. But the NFL, as well as college football, made it so you could no longer put any words or messages on your iPad because of that. Satan will do whatever he can to stop the word from getting out there. He'll block it. You know, Brother Gerald comes here sometimes, told me that he was over at the subway. He was downtown sharing the word at a subway, and he had some tracts he was passing out, you know, and it had pictures of the devil and how people need to trust God. And by the way, just so you all know, y'all seen the pictures of the devil. How many of y'all seen pictures of the devil, right? Those aren't the pictures, real pictures of the devil, okay? You ever seen a goat that looks like the devil? That's the goat of Mandes, by the way. That's the same thing the Egyptians worshipped in Egypt. And eventually he was associated with the devil. That's not true. The pitchfork and the rest of that came along in the 1100s. And the red, the color red, and the rest of that, you know, that's not how the devil looked. We know that the devil was an angel of light. And we know he can appear as an angel of light, okay? So, no, it doesn't look like that at all. But anyway, Gerald was passing out these tracts, and they're saying, trust Jesus. And so this guy who's there just comes up to him and says, man, praise the Lord. He said, yeah, praise God. He said, man, you're doing a good work, but let me just say this, man. He told him, don't hand out those tracts. People don't like to look at things that might scare them. So just don't do that. Plus, people are busy now, yeah? I said, Daryl, you should have turned around and said to him, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus, you fake Christian. Even in the body of Christ, there are people who are doing whatever they can to stand in the way. Satan will use them to stand in the way and discourage you. There are people, I mean, listen, one of the things that Satan tries to do is discourage me. He does. How many of y'all get discouraged? You try to do what's right and do the things of God, and you get discouraged. You don't come to church. I'm not talking about. Raise your hand. I get discouraged sometimes. I don't even want to come to church, amen. But that's how the enemy work. I take that, but I'm not like that. It didn't get me to that point, okay? But I'm just putting it out there in a joking way. But you know, John chapter 8, verse 31, notice here how the attacks are. The attacks are against the world, which we're going to see in a second, because he knows. John chapter 8, verse 31 through 32, Jesus said, you should know the truth, and the truth should do what? Set you free. If you're my disciples, indeed, you should know the truth, and the truth should set you free. Remember, we talked about that. If you abide in my word, see, Satan knows that that you can be set free if you get into the word of God. He knows that all things that pertain to life and godliness come through the knowledge of Jesus in 2 Peter 1, 3. He knows that the offensive weapon in Ephesians chapter 6 is the word of God. He knows from Matthew chapter 4 that Jesus quoted scripture to deal with him. So guess what? The attacks are against the word of God. In fact, he tries to make most Americans think he doesn't exist. Do you know statistics say that most Americans do not believe that Satan exists? We know from 1 Timothy chapter 4, he plants false doctrine within the church. Listen, you have apostolic churches, what's known as oneness church. If you ever been to an apostolic church, a oneness church that's against the Trinity, this kind of stuff, you think they're Christians. First century, this junk was called modalism. The Catholic Church, a cult, I'm sorry, they're practicing the doctrine of the Nicolaitans in the first century. Jehovah's Witnesses practicing Marcionism. One of the first and second centuries. I mean, there's nothing new under the sun. Satan will come in and do whatever he can to give false teaching. How many been places and they say, well, I ain't following no, you know, I ain't listening to that. Why you ain't listening to that? Because, man, that's that black Jesus, that's that white Jesus stuff. Jesus ain't a white man. Well, who says he was? We know Jesus wasn't white. He wasn't black either. But we know no man no longer after the flesh. We know Christ, Paul said, I think it's in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, no longer after the flesh. I remember one time I was over in the park downtown where I work at, and these guys were over there, and I said to them, and praise the Lord, man, I had a track and I handed my track. They said, oh, man, we Christians, man, praise God. We had a great conversation talking about Jesus. And I said, man, y'all just some cool dudes. It's like three of them. I said, man, where y'all work at? They said, we don't work. I said, why y'all don't work? The Bible says Jesus is coming back soon. Ain't no need to work. I said, well, how do you provide for your family and stuff? They said, well, God will provide. I said, who taught you that? Well, we go to this church where they teach you ain't even got to work. I said, y'all crazy. Who taught you that? False teaching in the church. Was it Shaquita and them called me recently and said that, you know, they ran into these people who say they're black Jews? I said, well, say to them, ask them this, what tribe are you from? I bet all of them say the tribe of Judah. Coach, you know, and even within the body of Christ, Satan, Luke chapter 8, verse 12, he tries to do whatever he can to snatch the word out of your heart. Luke 8, 12. Remember when Jesus gave the parable of the sower? He said that, but some people, when they hear the word of God, Satan comes along to snatch it out their heart after you heard it. So guess what? Right after service, he's going to snatch it out your heart. It may be right now during service. You're hearing it right now, and guess what? Your mind's somewhere else. What do I do when I get out of here? Did such and such call me? Your mind's somewhere else. And Satan will snatch it out of your heart. All of a sudden, you ever notice that you come to church, and all of a sudden you get to church, you know, you've been up all day, you've been happy all morning, but all of a sudden you get in here, you get sleepy. You know what I'm talking about? How many ever heard of sleep demons? Show up doing service time, and all of a sudden, I ain't been sleepy all morning. As soon as you walk out here, you'll be fine. You know what I'm saying? Satan, do whatever he can. It's not the word out your heart. It may even not be that. But just, you know what? As soon as you get out of here, all of a sudden, you know, you had a good service. You heard the word. It was very good. You was like, man, I'm going to do that. I'm going to start praying more. I'm going to start reading more. But then as soon as you get out of here, all of a sudden, guess what? Somebody call you up and say, you ain't no good. You ain't no good from the beginning. I hate your guts. And before you know what? Everything you've been taught this morning, just go out the window and you say blank you and everything else. All of a sudden, you just got in your flesh and Satan got in you and snatched the word up out of your heart. All hell done broke loose. Because he knows he can't stop some people from hearing it, but he knows that once he gets in there, he's going to do whatever he can to take it out. So you get in the car, you know, you've been listening to Christian music, you know what I'm saying, you get in the car and you turn on that wicked music before you know it and snatch the word out your heart. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11, he causes division in the church. Remember, Paul talks about that. And one of the things he said is that when division comes in the church, he does whatever he can to get advantage over you. And the word means to, like, you know, you ever wrestle somebody, and when you're wrestling, they get you in like a chokehold. That's what Satan tries to do to you and cause division in the church. And 1 Timothy 3:6 says it's usually with young believers. I've been a part of at least 3 church splits. I remember when I went to a church, I went a young believer. But I've been going there for some time. I've probably gone there for like 3-4 years. And I remember I loved a pastor, I loved assistant pastor. I loved everybody that was there. And I mean, they were like family to me. I loved the church, I loved the music, I loved everything. And all of a sudden, one day, the pastor stood up and said, "We've had a church split." And I'm telling you, it hurt me to my heart. And I said, "Well, where is such and such?" And they were like, "He's gone." Sister Pastor who counseled me and Lisa, marital counseling, because we were getting ready, well, it was pre-marital counseling, just so you all know. So he was gone, and the guitar guy I knew was gone, and the trumpet. It's like, wow. My heart was split. Satan to do that. It caused that division. And we need to know, when you hear somebody talking bad about me, and say, "Look, have you talked to the pastor about that? Have you gone one-on-one?" See, Satan will do that. He caused division in your household, won't he? Get the husband and wife to split when it comes to dealing with the kids. He caused division. Well, this needs to be done. No, that needs to be done. Instead of you coming together and saying, "Listen, I see what's going on. This ain't nothing but the devil. Let's get together and pray. Let's just get together and pray and let's God direct ourselves." I remember before we even got our church started, before I even became a pastor of a church, the pastor of our church said, "We're going to send you out," and so forth. Before that even happened, someone even within that particular group tried to split us up. We don't understand. This is what Satan does all day. He does whatever he can. Listen, I'm going to go another 5 minutes and we'll be done. He does whatever he can to come along and put doubt when it comes to the word of God. Remember it says in Genesis chapter 3, remember what Satan said? He said, "Has God really said?" You know, he gets people to doubt this Bible. "Oh, that's written by men and the rest of this stuff. Oh, no, that ain't true." And the rest. He'll do that. He'll even add unto the word of God. He'll screw it up. When you get a chance, read Matthew chapter 4, because of time, we can't go through it. He'll bring physical sickness. Luke chapter 13, verse 11. There's a woman who's been bent over for years. I forgot how many years exactly she's bent over. And remember, Jesus heals this woman and says that Satan, the devil, had attacked this woman. And he'll give you physical sickness. You know that. But this is part, now remember, this is why we pray. God, put that hedge around us. And even, Lord, if that hedge has to be removed and you allow this to happen, because this could be, because we know this did happen with Job. This could be the case with Paul in 2 Corinthians 5. We're not exactly sure, but I think it was. But whatever be the case, it is possible. And God's grace is sufficient even if he attacks our physical body. Are y'all feeling me on this? He can cause natural disasters. Natural disasters. You know, lots of times you see stuff in it, you know, on your insurance papers after the house has been destroyed or they done destroyed something else, they call it an act of what? An act of God. Instead of saying, listen, then maybe it was an act of Satan. We know from the book of Job, maybe even from Mark 5, that Satan can cause catastrophes, whirlwinds, tornadoes, a lot of this stuff. Ephesians 4:26 says he wants to get a foothold when it comes to forgiveness, to get you to the point where you become bitter and refuse to forgive somebody else. And then Satan uses that situation to get in there and make things worse. John 8:44 says he's a murderer and a liar from the beginning. He does whatever he can to commit murder. He'll have a group of guys go down in D.C. and go in the neighborhood, jump out of a car and start shooting and kill a little girl. That's the kind of stuff that he does. Revelation 12 verse 10 says he accuses the brethren day and night. Day and night he's standing before God saying, "Did you see Jerome? Look, did you see Jayla? Did you see Daphne? Did you see Miss Frank? Did you see what they was doing? And they call themselves Christians. Let me get them. Let me get them." Remember in Luke 22 verse 31, it says he wanted to sift Peter like wheat. He wanted to test Peter. He wanted to, Satan wanted to come along and destroy the life of Peter. Zechariah 3:1. Remember, Satan stands before God and he tries to accuse Joshua, the high priest, of being filthy and ungodly. And God stands up for him. We know from Daniel 7:25, he does whatever he can to wear out the saints. Have you ever felt like Satan was trying to wear you out and get you to quit on the things of God? In 1 Peter 5:8 says he walks around like a roaring lion, looking for whom he may devour. You know, they say lions roar usually when they feel threatened. He wants to do whatever he can to destroy your life. As we saw earlier, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Maybe next week we'll deal with just some ways of dealing with the enemy. We already talked about it already. The word of God, prayer, 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 prayer. We're going to look at it next week. No prayer, no power, no prayer, no palate, no prayer, no peace, no patience. All the peace when it comes to prayer, we'll look at that next week. Let's bow. Father, we thank you for the time we've had today. We've learned a lot today, Father. We've learned some good things, Daddy. Today, Lord, we've learned some ways that we can worship you. We can raise our hands, Lord. We can do all these things. Today, Lord, we've learned just how, Lord, the enemy attacks us. We've learned how you put a hedge around us. And we pray today, Father, that as we go about life, that you would be with us, you keep that hedge around us, that hedge of protection, and that you keep the wicked one from our houses, from our physical body, from our possessions. And like you said with Job, God, you would put a hedge around us. But if that hedge is removed, God, we know your grace is sufficient. Your strength is made perfect in weakness. And in the midst of whatever it is, we will still glorify you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Just one last caption before we leave. We saw some things that we can do when it comes to worship from the Book of Psalms. We said we should raise our hands, right? We should clap our hands, dance, use instruments, sing to the Lord. I hope that we start doing this during church service. Amen. We saw our thought of today to be thankful in all things, in for all things. We saw a question today about a hedge. And we also saw how that God is made it so that he's defeated the devil. He's given us the power of the enemy. But we saw what the enemy does all day. Him and his demons to destroy the people of God. So be aware of that. Do not be, in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, ignorant of Satan's devices. Amen. At the end here, can we all stand? At the end, Jerome, can you tell us to have a great day? That'd be a blessing. Lisa, we have a song here at the end.
Lord, I say thank you.
Lord, I say thank you. By the containers. You have it? Ready? Since we don't have Josh with us today, Lord, I say thank you. By the containers. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May he lift his countenance towards you and give you rest, give you peace. Direct your steps the rest of the day. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. And we don't have that, Lisa?
I don't know what this is.
Okay. We have a new person on the music today, and that's why we're having some confusion. But you have to plug it in. It's plugged in? All right. God bless.
Oh, no. Okay, give me one second. Sorry.
Lord, I give you my heart by the containers. Or I'm sure that's it. But Lord, I give you my heart.
Okay, it's Anthony Evans.
By Anthony Evans. God bless.
This is my desire to honor. Sing with me, heartbreak is our God. Oh, see how great is our God. Oh, see how great is our God. Oh, see
everyone have a blessed day.